It's wonderful to see you here this morning, brave souls. They always say that a long gospel means a short sermon. Yes, it can. Where else are you going to go? Everything is closed except us. We are open for business today because we are the hearty people of God. Interesting times. Interesting times when the hoarding of toilet paper replaces comfort food. It is interesting, as we have looked just in a couple of weeks past, speaking of the temptations of Jesus, the first temptation he had, being very hungry, was to make stones into bread so that he might consume it for himself. Does that ring a bell? We see in society, as we watch people in panic go and hoard things to themselves lest you have any, it is a confession of lack, it is fear, it is unfortunate that people supposedly of faith work this way, but it is that very fact within the basic nature of us, our lower nature as humans, to take for ourselves. You see, a lot of energy goes into confusion, and these are days of confusion, so I say to you this morning, relax. There is no better place to be than in God's house, with God's people. If you feel, as I do this past week, that your soul has been scrubbed with one of those wire barbecue brushes, you're not alone. We do feel raw in spirit from all that is going on. And there's a lovely old hymn that came to mind when I was walking the other morning, just thinking about all of the bad news that there is. A lovely old hymn that said, "There is a balm in Gilead that makes the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead that heals the weary soul." Regardless of whether it is the panic of the health situation, the stock market, the ineptness of our administration, or perhaps during the soul-searching time of this Lenten season, the wounds that we revisit, or the ones that show their face when we are in our most vulnerable situation, it is those things that come up during this time. It is a good Lenten journey, and so I say relax. There is hope, and there is rest. Blessing during a crisis. I've shared this story with you maybe a couple of times before, but like so many good things, it is worth repeating. During the financial crisis in 2008, I was working in the financial industry, worried about my own finances as well as our clients. Got into the elevator and greeted a woman just as we do automatically. "Hello, how are you?" And she looked at me and she said, "I am blessed, thank you. How are you?" And all of my theology went right down the drain. Because she knew something that eluded me. Went back to my office and realized that the stock market was not my source, nor was Merrill Lynch my source. God is my source. God is my refuge and my strength. There's bad news and the media seems to just love it. I think if blood was running in the streets, they would just have a wonderful time reporting it, the negative kind of things. But we have the good news of the gospel, which tells us that in the end of things, that love wins out, that God is in charge, no one else seems to be, and that we are secure in his love. Now, while we're paying attention to health issues, it is also time sometimes to dig deeply into our spiritual health issues. As I said, in walking in the morning, sometimes there are things that revisit me from way back. things that maybe I never thought about in recent years, or even ever told anybody about, things that are wounds that are looking for healing. And God wants us to deal with it. It isn't bringing these things up to make us feel guilty or ashamed. It is so that we will find healing. None of us are candid about our shortcomings and things that we've experienced, but there are still things that you keep to yourself. And it's just kind of when you reveal your shortcomings, it's sort of like pleading to a misdemeanor when you're hiding a felony because of the things that are deep within you. So I thought this week, the woman at the well, although there are a lot of ways we can look at this, was a woman who was deeply wounded, who was looking for more than water that was in the well. But that story of the woman of Samaria tells us that there is no one outside of the scope of God's love, and that God will find you wherever you are, even if it is in the Samarias of this world. Even though it's cleverly masked sometimes in people, everyone is made in the image and after the likeness of God. A Samaritan, same thing there. God does not see the labels that people put on us, and many of us have been labeled, or some of us have labeled ourselves as less than what God sees. So this is a story about a wounded woman going about her daily chores, trying to ignore the crisis in her life. What drove her to the well in the heat of the day? Most of the women went to the well early in the cool of the morning. Why did she go to the well in the heat of the day? And so it is a parenthetical note at this point. She's a woman who has had five husbands, and the one she had now was not her husband. Jesus saw all that. I don't know why. Some people would say she's an immoral woman. Or was she just a victim? Someone who was wounded again and again. And maybe the reason that she avoided coming in the early morning when the rest of the women were there is because she felt shame, she felt left out, she felt excluded. You see, the town is Sychar. And these might have been the real housewives of Sychar early in the morning. To make just a little bit of gossip, she felt left out and wanted to avoid even feeling left out, so she went at noon to get her water because they felt better. All of us, or many of us at least, have been wounded in a situation like that where we resist being around people that we feel make us feel less than we should. We don't know why she had been married so often. Perhaps in that society she had originally been married as a young teenager, and that husband had died and she'd been passed on to a brother and on to another brother, as society was, until she was considered damaged goods and nobody would have her. Maybe that was the case. Maybe she had been married to the first husband, and as was the cruelty of their law at that time, if the first husband found some flaw in her, including whether he liked the way she made dinner, which was within their scope, he could have written a bill of divorcement and sent her off. You see, the onus is on the husband in this case. In that society, a woman didn't go down and say irreconcilable differences and divorce her husband. The husband divorced the wife. So any situation here would have been because each of these husbands had either died or written a bill of divorcement, and there she was. Considered damaged goods, no one would even marry her. He might have been displeased with her appearance, and so she had to live life with that kind of wound, shunned by circumstances over which she had little control. This was her wound, this was her shame, this was her public secret. Her private sense of abandonment made her not want to be seen by anybody else. So, just as we have all been excluded. So she went to the well and she saw someone sitting there. Perhaps Someone's there. She didn't want to see anybody. But this was a man, and he spoke to her. Now, in that society, a man addressing a woman in the street or anywhere was a big no-no. She was a Samaritan. They didn't find the Jews. That was a bigger no-no. And she had had five husbands. There aren't enough no's to deal with that. She was someone that no one should be able to speak to. God always finds us, though, regardless of what our wounds are. And so they had a conversation. Scholars tell us that the conversation that Jesus had with her is the longest conversation that he had with anyone in all of the Gospels, at least as they are written. And what's amazing is that he offers her water, as the scripture tells us today, that gushes up into eternal life. And when she says, "Give me this water," what does he say to her? He said, "Go find your husband." That's when all of this came up. You see, the living water that he was bringing to her was not so much to quench the thirst, but it was to go right to the area that she was most wounded in, her exclusion from society. You want to stop trying to quench your thirst with things that never satisfy? You want this eternal life? It starts with being open. It starts with us being truthful about our original woundedness, which obscures the original beauty that God sees beyond all. We have heard it said that the old expression that water finds its lowest point, and living water also finds its lowest point. The water offered by Jesus Christ finds your lowest point, my lowest point. It flows to our original wounds, or those places that we don't want to deal with, and it tries to heal us more than all of the insufficient ways that we try, which is religion, success, therapy, working out, looking to get somebody to love you. Catholic theologian James Allison describes this kind of faith not as intellectually assenting to a set of theological prepositions, but as relaxing into the love and presence of God. We relax in the presence of God just as we do a good friend. And this is what happened to her. When it all came out, that living water found a fissure or a crack in her defenses, and that water trickled down to her lowest point, her deepest wound, her greatest need, so that she could relax. And she relaxed so much that she left her water jar at the well and went off into town to tell everybody else what had happened to her. The water jar may well be a metaphor for what we think will quench our thirst, but never does. I have some water jars that I need to leave behind in my own life, things that I think will make me whole, hide my wound, make me more lovable, I hope. I need to let them slip from my hand, even without caring that they are gone. So let the living water flow in the crack, in the fissure of your defenses today, down into your deepest need, and make you whole, just as God hopes to make us whole in all of the ways that we